Hello, good evening, televiewers. Welcome to today's edition of Prime Hour on MyMedia Prime. This evening, we are going to be revisiting the special status for the Southwest and Northwest region. We are going to be dissecting what is actually special in the special status. We are talking this with our panelists who are already in the house. We also are very, very sad with the fact that we wanted key actors to be part of this program today. All of them turned down our invitation to come and explain better what our special status is all about. We even sent our field correspondents to talk to them to be able to explain what it is all about. We are talking about members of regional and local councils for the Southwest and Northwest regions. Most of them said they were not ready to talk about this. So we are going to be discussing with our panelists in the house. Our consultant, Apostle Lambe Valentine Gua, is in the house with us. Good evening and welcome.
Good evening, Leo. Good evening, my co-panelists. Good evening, Cameroonians and viewers of Prime Hour. It's a joy to be here this evening again to dissect the special status. God bless you. And I thank the Lord Jesus for giving us the opportunity to be alive and strong today.
Okay. Atiat Hilarius Azonwe is here with us. He's a journalist. Good evening and welcome.
Good evening, Leo. Good evening to Apostle Ambe. Good evening to the televiewers of My Media Prime and the viewers of Prime R. I expect that it's going to be an interesting and a fruitful exchange. We hope that the authorities will listen and take the recommendations in good faith.
We also are in the company of D4. Richard, good evening, D4. We're glad to have you once again this evening.
Good evening, Leonard, and thanks for having me, and good evening to our viewers. I think today we're going to discuss this very important definitely have to affect the current crisis that is affecting the two regions of Cameroon, the two English-speaking regions of Cameroon.
Okay, we are expecting the arrival into our studios of Mr. Youth Jean-Claude Fils. He is going to be representing the CPDM on this platform. I just spoke with him minutes ago. He's caught in traffic, but he's going to be part of this edition of the program. Apostle Lambe Valentine Gua, when we talk of the special status, before we get into what is contained in the law, do people actually, do people understand what the special status is all about? Or you as a person?
Well, in the generic sense, everybody understands what special status to me is a certain degree of autonomy from statistics gathered across other special status granted to other regions of the world. But we are still to find out actually what it means in Cameroon. Because since the so-called special status was announced, we have not seen any step put in place or any step taken to enact the special status. We've seen the description of the different responsibilities of the individuals or the elected individuals, but we are yet to find them go to work, and we're yet to find some of those institutions that they spoke about put in place. So everybody is totally confused as far as the Cameroonian special status or the Northwest and Southwest special status is concerned. The special status is a form of state which is practiced in most nations in the world. By the grace of God, in the course of this debate, we are going to be analyzing other countries and see how they've been able to manage it to curb crisis in their countries. I don't think the Cameroonian authorities are serious to actually put an end to the Anglophone crisis, because if they were, I'm sure the special status would have been a very strong weapon they would have used to at least pacify at least 75% of the Northwest and South population before thinking of other measures to bring down the remaining 25%. But as far as we are concerned in Cameroon or the Northwest and the Southwest, the special status is still a farce.
It's still a farce. But the common man on the ground, do they really understand that the Northwest and Southwest now operate under a special status?
How? There is nothing. Nothing has changed. Individuals were elected, the so-called election in quotes, are called and appointed and given responsibilities, and even the persons who were appointed, they are somehow fostered, because it's like giving somebody an office with an assignment. No job description. You are keeping them frustrated. They are looking up to you, waiting for you to give them a go ahead, give them a budget to execute the assignment. They also are kept in total confusion. Even the persons who were elected into offices are somehow dumbfounded with the so-called special status. The last time we read through it, it was just it was vague. It has not been applied. It has not had any effect. The result of everything we met before the special status is still the same. I'm sure if at all the applicability of this special status was put in place, then probably would have been able to have some better results in the north and the southwest. But for now, the special status still remains a dream that is yet to be enacted.
Okay, yet to be enacted. Atiati, you are from the ground. Do people actually feel that something was done in their favor as a special status different from the other eight regions of this country?
Well, even before we talk about the special status, let's look at the state, the nature of the state, for example. Cameroon, Article 1 of the Constitution says that Cameroon is a decentralized unitary state. So it means that decentralization went into force in 1996. But to date, decentralization has not been applied as it should be. At the major national dialogue, it was one of the recommendations that 15% of the state budget should be sent down to the decentralized units, the local councils, the regional councils, and the city councils. And looking at the 2021 state budget, it stands at 4,865.2 billion francs CFA. And if you take into consideration the fact that Cameroon has 360 councils, 14 city councils, and 10 regional councils, then we have 384 councils. If you look 15% of the 4,865 billion of state budget, that will give you 729.78 billion. If you distribute this amount to the 384 councils, it means that each council is supposed to have 2.1 billion. And if we go by the information that came out from the Kona Road, the National Road Council of 2013, that a kilometer of road in Cameroon is 100 million. It means that each council, like the council in Lebealem, Alo, Wabane, Omenji, is going to have 2.1 billion. And with that 2.1 billion, they can tar 10.1 kilometer of road each year from this special decentralized credit of 15% of the state budget. That alone tells you that the development of this country is being held back by some people in Yaoundé who don't want things to happen. Because if this extra credit had gone down to the councils since 1996, I'm sure that Lebealem should have been a city like Yaoundé. But because some people in Yaoundé don't want things to work, we are where we are today. So I think that it starts with the decentralization process that was supposed to start in 1996, but it took until 2004 for the decentralization laws to come into effect. And until this day, we are talking about advanced decentralization, but nothing is happening. We saw how the city mayor of Kumba and the city mayor of Limbe were crying on Saturday before the Minister of Decentralization and Local Development when he went to inaugurate the FEICOM office in Limbe. They said they have not been able to pay staff because there's no money. The credits government is supposed to send, government has not sent. So it means that the process of decentralization is not working at all in the first place. So when you start talking about special status, it will just be a disaster because the process that special status is a subset of the decentralization process. If decentralization is not working, then I wonder where we are. We are in May of 2021, and the 15% that government is supposed to send to the local councils throughout the country, the 2.1 billion, if we were to share per council, it has not gone. So how can we be talking about special status in a system that has agreed that it will not work? Because I begin to ask myself, what has President Biya in his close to 40 years in power started and completed to the end? When you look at the ring road, it has never been completed. You look at even the Olembe Stadium today, we are still to complete a stadium that we were supposed to use in 2019. When you look at a country that is unable to link its economic capital to the political capital by an auto road in the 21st century, in fact, in 2021, Cameroon cannot link the political capital to the economic capital. So it means that there is no good faith, there is no goodwill for the head of state or his collaborators to ensure that the projects that he starts should even get to a logical end. There are some of them that have even just ended on paper, like the Limbe Deep Sea Port project, among many others. Even the Ring Road, because he said he was personally supervised the Ring Road in 1983. How many years are we? Nothing has been done. So I'm asking myself, which project has President Biya started and completed? And Cameroonians can look at it and be proud that, okay, this is what we can hold President Paul Biya as having achieved. Because even democracy that he says we should credit him for. I'm not sure what we have in Cameroon is democracy. Democracy goes beyond holding elections periodically. It includes the rule of law. It includes the justice, the presence of peace and development, and the absence of corruption, nepotism, and all the ills that Cameroon is known for. Because in 1999, we won gold as the most corrupt country in the world. I think in 1998 it was the same. And since then, things have not improved. So I think that the special status will not be different. Because as to the best of my knowledge, President Biya has not started any project and successfully implemented it, and for Cameroonians to see the results.
Okay. And for Richard, out there in the U.S., I will go into the law itself. I'm going to part 5, which says special status of the Northwest and Southwest regions. Chapter 1, general provisions. The Northwest and Southwest regions shall have a special status in accordance with the provisions of Article 62 of the Constitution. Sub 2 of Section 327 of that law says, the special status referred to in subsection 1 above shall confer on the Northwest and Southwest regions a specific organizational and operational regime based on the historical, social and cultural values of these regions, with due respect for the primacy of the states and national unity and solidarity. What has changed according to your view, Jifor Richard?
Thank you so much, Leonard. I think I should start by looking at the basis. Let's look at the background of this special status. How did it come about? We understand that the special status came about as a result of the crisis in the Northwest and Southwest region that led to what they called the National Dialogue. After the National Dialogue, we heard about this issue of special status, and a lot of people were trying to figure out what this special status really means, because that was the first time Cameroonians got to hear about special status. So many of us were trying to figure out what it is. And that is how we started doing our research to find out what special status is, and to realize that it is not actually a new thing. It is something that has existed in so many countries, in India, in China, Hong Kong. You know, Hong Kong is a special status territory to China. And then we know of Quebec in Canada. And so when we look at all of these things and we saw what was given to them as special status, there was some hope among Cameroonians and some optimists like myself. We thought that at least the government want to take some steps to make things right with the English-speaking Cameroonians. And so to cut a long story short, what we were expecting as far as this so-called special status was concerned, and what in fact we were made to understand by so many people who were propagating this whole issue of special status, was that we were supposed to have an elected House of Assembly, Regional House of Assembly. We were to have a Regional House of Chiefs. We were also expecting to have elected governors. And we were also expecting to have a separate budget for the English-speaking regions. Those were our expectations. And in fact, the expectations of a vast majority of Cameroonians. It wasn't too long, especially when the bill relating to special status was tabled in Parliament, that many of us started realizing that it was all a scam. It was just some kind of scam. You see, what happened is that this regime, what it does is that when there is a problem, they try to pacify the problem. They don't look for its lasting solution to that problem. Just like the way they do their roads. A road gets bad. Instead of constructing the road completely, they go and do patches here and there. So they look for short-term measures instead of looking for long-term measures. As a matter of fact, I don't want to, the other panelists have explained elaborately how the whole special status thing is a total failure. We have seen that it doesn't really meet the aspirations of many English-speaking Cameroonians as we expected. And if we even start to ask ourselves the question, what is special about the status? What is special? Because what obtains in the Northwest and Southwest region is the same that obtains in the littoral region, in the central region, east region, and in all the other regions of the country. So what makes this special? Because when we talk about special status, we are talking about a situation where in a particular, in this particular region, they have, they give the particular, as you write in the law, special characteristics because of its historical and maybe its historical disadvantage of this region. And so that, in fact, was what we were expecting to see from this whole special status, but it has shown to be a total failure, and we are soon have, we soon have to go back to the drawing board.
Okay, we soon, you and Lou are going back to the drawing board. bonsoir, bienvenue.
Bonsoir au milieu des téléspectateurs qui nous suivent en ce moment.
Oui, statut spécial pour le Nord-Ouest et le Sud-Est, la décentralisation, ça piétine. Okay.
Vraiment, pour ceux qui attendaient quelque chose de ce statut spécial dans le Nord-Ouest et le Sud-Ouest, certainement aujourd'hui voient qu'ils se sont leurrés quelque part. Parce que ceux qui ne connaissent pas le Cameroun vont attendre encore, ou bien vont espérer même encore vont espérer quelque chose du régime actuel. Mais ce qui est certain, c'est que depuis 38 ans que nous sommes là, c'est un régime que nous connaissons déjà tous. Le régime ne va rien apporter de spécial aujourd'hui. Et même, les jours sont passés, nous voyons ce qui se passe avec le Nord-Ouest et le Sud-Ouest. Rien en ce qui concerne le régime spécial. Moi, nous nous sommes attendus à un moment donné qu'il y ait beaucoup plus de liberté en ce qui concernait, ces deux régions. Mais nous nous rendons compte que... Nous nous rendons compte que il n'y a rien de spécial dans ce qu'on a mis dans le régime spécial dans ces deux régions. Et vraiment, au Nord-Ouest et au Sud-Ouest, il y a de quoi. Là-bas, les populations ont été habituées à beaucoup plus de liberté, à beaucoup plus de mouvance en ce qui concerne même la gestion de la vie politique, en ce qui concerne la gestion même de la vie sociale, et que jusqu'à ce moment, on leur a trompé. Que bon, ok, on vous accorde le régime spécial. Enfin, moi, je vois ça comme étant une manière, encore une fois de plus, pour le régime de Paul Biya, de tromper ces populations qui ont un mal-être en eux, qui réclament des choses qui sont réelles et qui nécessitent des solutions beaucoup plus poussées que ce régime spécial qui en rien n'a ajouté quoi que ce soit dans la vie de ces populations.
Mais vous voulez dire que rien n'a changé?
Oui, mais dites-moi, quelle est la preuve? Parce que quand on dit que quelque chose a changé, cela voudrait dire qu'on apporte quand même des éléments qui nous prouvent que cela a changé. Moi, je me serais attendu qu'à un moment donné, qu'on donne, quoi, par exemple, on vote un budget spécial pour améliorer les conditions de vie dans ces deux régions, qu'on vote, par exemple, des lois qui permettent à ces populations d'être beaucoup plus libres. Parce qu'il ne faut pas oublier, ces deux régions font quand même une particularité historique au Cameroun. Ces deux régions, depuis longtemps, n'ont pas été gérées comme nous ici, je vais dire, au Grand Sud. Non, mais ces deux régions ont des choses spéciales qu'on devrait appliquer là-bas. Okay. Bon, mais le régime spécial... Il n'a rien ajouté là-bas. Ce sont les mêmes routes qui sont coupées. Ce sont des mêmes problèmes. Je voyais encore la dernière fois, lorsqu'il y a une petite pluie, ce sont des inondations partout. Il manque d'eau, il manque d'électricité. Il manque tout dans ces régions. Okay. Et il y a de quoi dire que le régime spécial n'a rien apporté.
Ok, good evening to you, Gilberto Solo, and to you, René Monono, and to you, NS Boma, and Lefan Bertrand, all watching via social media. Gilberto Solo, Dr. Ako John Ako lost a wife. She was buried, I'm sure, last Saturday. So he's still mourning the wife. I'm sure we are going to give him some time before he will be able to join us back here. But as for the others, we hope that very shortly they are going to be joining us. I want to read this portion again to you. Apostle Ambi Valentine. That is sub 2 of section 327 says, the special status referred to in subsection 1 above shall confer on the northwest and southwest regions a specific organizational and operational regime based on the historical, social and cultural values of these regions, with due respect for the primacy of the state and national unity and solidarity. Is there anything organizational wise that has changed within these two regions compared with the other regions?
Except you'll be a stranger to say something has changed. As much as I know this country and I've lived here for the time being, I'm very convinced and I know very well that nothing has changed. You see, when it comes to special status, when we talk about special status, there are a lot of countries in the world that has given specific regions special status. There are about 121 regions in the world from 40 different nations that have special status. And if you go to take analysis on the special status, they are almost independent, if not at all completely independent. We have cases like India. It gave Jammu and Kashmir. It was a state that was to decide either to join India, which was populated with Hinduism, or to join Palestine. Pakistan was Muslim-like. But they decided to accede. Accede means the opposite of secede. They acceded with India. India gave a special status in 1947. And that special status allowed them to practice or carry out their cultural and educational distinction from every other part in India. Now, if you go, France has practiced it. It has about 7 regions. Britain has practiced it. China has practiced it. Hong Kong, Gansu, Zhejiang, and Tibet, New Mongolia are all special status regions in China. Now, if you look at the special status we are talking in Cameroon here, special status give a certain level of autonomy. For instance, at least 60% of power is controlled by those individuals. This special status in Cameroon, according to what was written in the article there, it says that the executive president of the regional assembly shall be the one to run the affairs of that region. In other words, the office of a government delegate, the office of a DO, the office of an SDO, and all the so-called city mayors are no longer needed in those regions. In 1960-61, they said the federal system was expensive because we had 2 people occupying the same offices. For instance, there was a minister of education in French Cameroon, there was a minister of education in English speaking Cameroon. So 2 persons occupying the same office was expensive. But now it's even the worst because 5 persons are doing the same job. We have city mayors, we have municipal mayors, we have DO, we have SDOs, we have governors, they will have regional presidents again. What are all these personalities doing? Is it to stamp documents? Is it to give to sell stamps? Or what are they doing? Because you go to the DO's office, the same thing you can do in the mayor's office. What are the functions of all this bundle of offices? Paying money, giving offices, and giving responsibility to people who do not even have anything to do. Now they have appointed. They are regional delegates. Now with this regional delegate, what are they doing? They have nothing to do. If an executive president in the region is appointed, the governor has no use because that's the person to run the activity of the nation. Now we are saying that the federal system was costly because 2 persons occupy one office. Now 5 persons or 6 persons occupying one office. They are paying a DO for a job that was supposed to have been done by a mayor, done by a regional president, done by an SDO, or done by a DO. What are all these offices combined together doing there? If at all they are doing special status, all they were supposed to have started by dismantling all these offices of governors. Because the regional president is exactly the role of a governor. And that is an elected individual. Somebody who is appointed should not be given the role of somebody who is elected. That's an abuse of democracy. If the people choose an individual to lead them, you don't pick somebody and then overshadow the person to rule somebody that has been selected by the people. And we know that all the regional councillors and the presidents are elected into offices. Why then do we take deals who left administrative Enam to come and begin to control? The next thing they have to do is to take all these guys who left Enam who occupy responsibility in Cameroon and scrape, because I don't see the function of Enam in the country. That's what we have to understand. So if we are talking about specific, nothing has changed. They say House of Chiefs, they were elected. If you ask the chiefs, they have no responsibility, practically no job. The people who were appointed as regional councillors, they have no job. Some they are frustrated. They were supposed to have at least 4 sessions per year. And each session per year,
a regional councillor was supposed to live with at least 2 million. This is May. They have had just one session. Very soon we'll go to June. Is it towards December that we'll hold a second session or what? Because even the regional councillors do not actually know what they are supposed to do. They are talking about controlling education, controlling health. We have a delegate of education. Basic, delegate of secondary, and then we have delegates of health. If those delegates are still in place, what are the regional councillors coming to do in the educational and the health sector? That is the question we are asking.
They will give advice.
What advice?
Monsieur Claude, oui, je vous ai vu avec le code. Le voilà. Oui.
C'est très important.
Oui, très important. Ma part est là-dedans. Oui. Oui. Pourquoi est-ce que vous avez l'impression que la population, le bas peuple, comprend vraiment ce que veut dire la décentralisation? Est-ce qu'ils sentent ça? Est-ce qu'ils ressentent ça?
En ce qui concerne déjà les communes d'arrondissement et les maires des villes, ils le sentent déjà puisqu'ils le voient les maires des villes au travail. Mais maintenant, en ce qui concerne les conseils régionaux, le 1er mai dernièrement, nous avons fêté les 100 premiers jours tout simplement parce qu'en réalité, les présidents, les exécutifs des conseils régionaux sont en place depuis le 22 janvier.
Oui.
Et le problème qui se pose, c'est qu'on comprend qu'il faudrait que les uns et les autres voient déjà comment les routes sont en train d'être goudronnées et tout. Mais avant d'en arriver à tous ces éléments-là, il y a des études préalables. Il y a d'abord toute une programmation. Il y a des faisabilités, ainsi de suite. Je vous prends un exemple simple. Les conseils régionaux viennent pratiquement de parachever la mise en place, la conception des avant-projets. Des projets de budget qui seront bientôt soumis à des délibérations au niveau des premières sessions des conseils régionaux. Vous savez que l'organe délibérante, c'est le conseil régional. Dans le cadre du statut spécial, il y a donc la chambre haute et la chambre basse. Donc, ce qui voudrait dire que ça doit passer par tous ces éléments-là. Et un budget, c'est quoi? Parce que les uns les autres, nous sommes depuis 2013 dans une orientation des budgets programmes. Donc, pour en arriver donc au budget programme, vous devriez avoir une vision du développement de la région qu'il fallait déjà mettre. Et je vous rappelle que les conseils régionaux sont installés depuis le 22 janvier. Ensuite, après cette vision, vous devriez avoir un plan régional de développement. C'est un document. Vous devez avoir un schéma d'aménagement du territoire régional. Et ensuite, vous conseillez tous ces éléments-là dans le cadre donc, du budget programme. C'est à l'issue donc, de ce budget programme-là où vous avez donc, ce qu'on appelle les engagements.
Oui,
et maintenant les plans de performance.
Monsieur Jean-Claude, vous avez commencé avec les études. On sait ce qui s'est passé avec la décentralisation où les maires ont pratiquement passé 5 ans 10 ans à faire des formations, des études pour comprendre comment la décentralisation devrait marcher. Est-ce que ce ne serait aussi pas le cas avec les régionaux comme nous sommes, comme vous l'expliquez?
Non.
Parce qu'ils ont un mandat de 5 ans.
Oui.
Ils vont faire des études pendant combien d'années et puis ils vont réaliser quand?
Non, c'est pas qu'ils vont faire des études nouvelles ou bien le Cameroun se crée de nouveau. Nous connaissons là où les besoins se posent. Par exemple, on peut vous dire que on a besoin d'une route Manfé-Koumba. Ça ne relève pas de la création des conseils régionaux parce que le pays existait déjà. Mais les conseils régionaux doivent s'approprier de ces besoins. Et pour s'approprier donc de ces besoins, ça voudrait dire par exemple que avant cette compétence relevait d'où et de qui? On vous parle donc de transfert de compétences, on vous parle de transfert des ressources. Le conseil régional s'approprie cela et ensuite maintenant l'implémente. Mais on vous dit aussi également que vous pouvez avoir des besoins qui sont au niveau des arrondissements, au niveau des maires et des villes et au niveau donc de la région. Il faudrait que le plan de développement régional soit harmonisé avec l'ensemble donc, de toutes ces collectivités, y compris le plan national de développement par rapport à l'économie nationale. Donc, c'est tous ces éléments-là que les conseils régionaux sont en train de travailler depuis leur installation. Et je puisse vous dire qu'ils sont à pied d'œuvre. Et le statut spécial, lorsque le confrère de tout à l'heure disait que sur le plan de l'éducation, il y a une cacophonie parce qu'il y a plusieurs intervenants, j'ai eu l'impression tout de suite qu'il n'a pas lu le code général des collectivités territoriales décentralisées. Parce que par exemple, en matière d'éducation, c'est bien établi, c'est clair que l'éducation de base relève de la compétence des communes. Je ne sais pas si vous voyez. De la compétence commune. Les lycées et collèges, donc c'est-à-dire l'enseignement secondaire, ça relève de la compétence des conseils régionaux. Le supérieur relève de la compétence du ministère de l'enseignement supérieur. Donc, la politique nationale de l'éducation est faite par les ministères en charge de cette éducation. Et puis maintenant, quant à l'amélioration du cadre de vie, la création des établissements en ce qui concerne l'épanouissement, et tout, c'est ces compétences-là dont nous avons relevé. Okay. Donc, ce qu'on va dire qu'il n'y a pas un problème à dire qu'on a un maire qui a compétence sur les écoles maternelles et primaires un délégué, par exemple, départemental.
Monsieur Jean-Claude, ce que vous dites là, I want you to respond to Monsieur Jean-Claude, because I will read where it says that the regional commissioner says the commissioner for economic development shall be responsible for implementing the policy of page 84. Shall be responsible for implementing the policy of the region on the exercise of devolved powers in the fields of economic action, environmental and natural resources management, planning, territorial development, public works, town planning, and housing. Section 363 says the commissioner for health and social development shall be responsible for implementing the policy of the region on the exercise of devolved powers in the fields of health and social action. Are we saying that there is going to be an overhauling in the not only that is how the ministries function? Because if these regional councils are expected to do these things, when we know that there are ministries in charge of this, and these ministries are represented at a regional level, a divisional, subdivisional level, how is this going to work?
Well, like I said, that since the passage into law of the bill on local and regional authorities, on regional and local authorities, President Biya has not appointed ministers. It means that he's taking his time to reorganize government, because, like I said, the role of the regional councils is to promote economic planning and social development. So it means that it takes away some portions of what the Minister of Economic Planning and Regional Development used to perform, and it brings it down to the region. So it means that ministry may not be necessary anymore, because in the past we had the Minister of Economy and Finance, but then they saw that the work of developing and planning the regions was much, and they put a separate ministry to perform this task. So it means there's need for us to go back to the days of the Ministry of Economy and Finance, so that the issues of economic planning, issues of social development can be left in the hands of the regions. And the staff that used to be under the regional delegations should automatically be sent to the regional president, so that he can use the engineers if he needs, if he can use the advisors, he can use the town planners at his beck and call, because there is no need to have a regional president who is the chief executive officer of the region. And at the same time, when he needs an engineer, he writes to a regional delegate to request for an engineer to carry out the project in his jurisdiction. I think that there's a lot of friction in that case, because already these regional presidents, unlike state governors in Nigeria who have the powers to command law and order, state representatives appointed by the head of state, in this case governors, are the ones who charged with maintaining law and order. It means to command the police force, to command the military within the regions, is the preserve of the governor, who is the preserve of the state. And so the regional presidents are reduced to economic development and social development. So if there's another ministry that is so big again, taking charge of economic development, social development, so it means that the role, because the primary role, keeping special status aside, the role of regions is to ensure economic development, social development. Special status aside. These are the two functions of the regions. So if we have ministries who are still carrying out all of these things, then there will be duplication of function. So it will mean that the reason why the federation, the federal system of government was scrapped in 1972 was not because of economic reasons. Because at this point, we are running a very bogus administration with every... We saw the city mayor of Limbe, who is asking if city councils have been left out in the process to send down competencies to councils. Because he says it will appear the resources and the competencies have not reached them. So it simply tells us that these structures were not necessary. We did not need them. When you go to a country like Turkey, they have provinces. And these provinces have cities. A city like Istanbul, they now have small councils. And they have a city mayor. The city mayor is city mayor for Istanbul, who is like the regional president that we have here. We were not supposed to have city councils anymore. All the councils were supposed to be under the regional president that is elected by the councillors and takes charge of the day-to-day development of the regions and is answerable to those who elected them, not to a middleman, the city councils, whose place I don't see. And the law says here that the senators, the parliamentarians, the senators, members of parliament, and mayors shall attend the regional assembly meetings. So it's only a way to collect the small money that the regional councils have, because they have to pay sitting allowances to those who attend, that the state representative shall attend regional assembly meetings. And the law says in section 325 that if he doesn't have time, he can ask for a postponement of the regional assembly meeting, and that the reports, the regional assembly, they shall present their reports, all bills that are adopted and everything shall be submitted to him. For what? When you say they should submit all adopted bills, all resolutions, everything to the representative of the state, for what?
Okay.
When they say he must be present in regional assembly meeting, that he doesn't have a vote and that he cannot chair, but that whenever he asks the floor, he must be given, and whatever he says should be taken in the minutes. What for? So it tells you that even this special status arrangement, the government is giving and taking. Government says that in section 329 of the law, that the Northwest and Southwest regions under special status shall be freely managed by the president of the regional executive body. But then it says that this free management shall be done under certain conditions that shall be laid down by law. So is it that those conditions we are waiting for? That a regional president, a minister comes to Limbe to inaugurate a building by FECOM, and the regional president is so timid, he's so fighting, it's like the head of state is around and he's trembling. We had city mayors were the ones who were saying that we have not paid staff for the last 6 months, the credits that the state is supposed to send, they have not sent. The 15% of the state budget that was supposed to send to councils, and that was agreed upon at a major national dialogue. And the head of state says that he is fast-tracking the resolution and the recommendations that were made at the major national dialogue. Well, they call them recommendations, not resolutions. That they are supposed to implement those recommendations. He has implemented some. What is so difficult in sending down this 15% to the regional councils? And what is so difficult for a regional president to stand up to the minister and explain that, Mr. Minister, this is what is happening, this is what is wrong, that you sent us machines that were programmed in the French language, and that we are in Boya, we are managing an Anglo-Saxon community, and you sent us computers with software in French. That if it still takes the Minister of Decentralization to go and look for a building that will house the regional councils. So what is the role of the regional president?
Okay, and for Richard, I will read some sections of section 350. Nine sub one. It says the president of the regional executive council shall be the chief executive of the region as such. He shall one, represent the region in all civil matters before the law courts. But I'll go down to say he shall authorize the revenue and expenditure of the region subject to separate provisions laid down by the laws in force. Do you see them actually doing that in the Northwest and Southwest regions? Is it possible?
Yeah, that sounds very interesting. And that comes back to some very pertinent questions that Apostle Ambe raised there. When you say chief executive officer, you see it sounds so nice that somebody would think that they are the ones who are in control of the region. As a matter of fact, Let me just say here that when a friend of mine got into this region, regional election thing, and I asked him, what powers do you have? And he kept going to the law and pinching part of it and throwing to me. And and I told him that this looks, sounds very, this sounds very interesting. But when it comes to implementation, that is when you start realizing that this is all some kind of scam. Because when you say the chief executive officer of the region, anybody who understands English language knows that they are the overall in the region. They are the people who are, that is the person who's manning the region. If they say a chief executive officer of the company, that is the person who is in charge. That's the person who is in charge. But you see, the regional presidents are like, they're like beggars to the governors. They are trembling to the governors. And then you see, the law itself is contradictory because it goes somewhere and says these people are being supervised by the governors, by these appointed governors. They are the ones to supervise them. So they are under their supervision. So I start asking the question, what is the place of, how can that president become an executive officer and then someone else within the region is supervising him? And as a matter of fact, that person is actually the chief executive officer. So as a matter of fact, Leonard, the whole context of this law, if we want to go by the law, you realize that there is a lot of contradiction within the law. You realize that there is a lot of things that are playing with words within it. But when it comes to the implementation on ground, you ask any ordinary person, any observer, keen observer, he will tell you that none of this thing is happening on the ground. None of it is happening. So it's just some kind of, I don't know how to put it, it's just some kind of smoke screen. It's a smoke screen just to tell Anglophones that, or maybe tell Cameroonians that they, the English-speaking regions have been given some special status. Let us go back to look at what the law says about the House of Chiefs. The law says there is going to be a House of Chiefs. Do we have a House of Chiefs? We have chiefs being nominated and sent to the council. They are just being members of the regional council. We don't have any House of Chiefs, they say, as the law says. So you see, they themselves won't get the law. The law itself, which does not even befit what the special status should be, is itself contradictory. Coming again to the implementation of some little aspect of the law that they could have implemented, they still again are not doing so in the implementation. So it is, all of this is just some form of pacifying. I like the question Aposande asked. If we have the regional councils to take care of education and all of that, why do we have the regional delegate of education? And what role will the regional delegate of education be playing? What role will those regional delegates of maybe economic and finance and all of that, what role will those people be playing when we have the regional councils there? So you see, it is a whole complete confused system. It's a total confusion. It sets confusion almost to everybody, even the regional delegates themselves. They don't even understand what they are supposed to do. Then the regional councils themselves, they are confused. So it's just total confusion, and this confusion is done deliberately. It's not that they don't know what they are doing. They know exactly what they are doing, and they are just playing all of this game to manipulate and just deceive Cameroonians.
Ok, Diffo, vous voulez répondre?
Un petit peu quand même, parce que je dis une fois de plus qu'il ne doit même pas avoir des confusions à la compréhension de savoir pourquoi on a un délégué régional qui relève du pouvoir déconcentré et on a un président du conseil régional qui relève de la décentralisation. Imaginez-vous que à chaque département, on puisse avoir une politique de l'éducation. On va avoir des Camerounais qui seront formés par divers types d'orientations. Il faudrait une centralisation d'une politique d'orientation de l'éducation. C'est ce que représente le délégué régional de l'éducation. Maintenant, quant à la création des établissements, mais ils sont autorisés par le ministère, parce que c'est tout à fait normal. Mais en ce qui concerne, par exemple, l'augmentation du nombre de salles de classe, des tables bancs, le parquet minimum, la gestion des enseignants, et ainsi de suite, ça relève donc des collectivités territoriales décentralisées. Il n'y a pas de cacophonie à ce niveau-là. Lorsque vous avez, vous faites le bilan, par exemple, en début d'année d'un établissement, vous dites cet établissement a besoin, par exemple, de 20 salles de classe pour pouvoir accueillir peut-être 1000 autres nouveaux élèves. À partir de ce moment-là, vous avez besoin de vous adresser à la collectivité territoriale. Mais quant à la politique, c'est-à-dire le calendrier national, l'orientation, le contenu des programmes et tout, c'est le ministère. Et maintenant, le ministère est donc représenté sur le plan déconcentré par ses délégués régionaux et départementaux. Est-ce que c'est compliqué? C'est pas du tout compliqué. Il n'y a pas une cacophonie à ce niveau. La commission d'éducation au niveau du conseil régional, elle est là, par exemple, pour statuer sur les propositions soumis du plan de l'éducation du président du conseil régional, donc c'est-à-dire de l'exécutif du conseil régional. Je vous prends un exemple. Je vous ai dit tout à l'heure qu'on veut par exemple 20 salles de classe au lycée bilingue de Deido. Le président du conseil régional soumet cela d'abord à la commission de l'éducation. La commission de l'éducation qui va regarder en fonction des moyens, des disponibilités, des engagements que le président du conseil régional ou bien du bureau exécutif du conseil régional va prendre dans le cadre du statut spécial. À partir de ce moment-là, ensuite, ils vont partir au niveau de la délibération.
Le commissaire de l'éducation va statuer sur cela, mais que fait donc le délégué régional? Est-ce qu'il n'est pas censé connaître tout cela?
Non, on se comprend très bien. En ce qui concerne les moyens, les besoins de financement, l'amélioration du cadre de vie, ça relève de la collectivité territoriale décentralisée. Mais en ce qui concerne la politique de l'éducation, le contenu des programmes, les manières scolaires, ça relève du ministère central. C'est pas compliqué à comprendre.
Before this regional council scheme, who were the ones managing that politique?
Non, mais qu'on se comprenne très bien.
Parce que ça va arriver à un niveau qu'on va commencer à créer les positions pour les gens qui essuient la nous des gens. Parce que vous n'avez pas rien à donner pour les gens. Ils n'ont pas de travail.
Non, comment non?
Nous avons donné la responsabilité pour les gens qui essuient la nous des gens pour le caca.
Non.
Quel travail il fait quel travail là-bas?
Mais permettez que...
Qui faisait ce travail avant que cette région ait crié?
Le travail était toujours assuré. Et d'abord, l'éducation est une mission régalienne de l'État. Donc, c'était toujours le ministère en charge de l'éducation qui s'en occupait.
What will happen at the level of health? The same? The person in charge of health would do what you are saying, and then the divisional and regional delegations of public health are going to be doing what you're saying.
C'est pas la même chose. C'est-à-dire les compétences sont bien établies. Hein. Il faut bien les lire et c'est bien établi. Et il n'y a pas cacophonie. Et maintenant, le représentant de l'État est là pour se rassurer que, conformément aux lois qui sont prévues par la réglementation en vigueur. Et tout, est-ce que les conseils régionaux ou bien les mairies des villes ou les communes d'arrondissement sont en train de respecter la loi? Est-ce que les décisions et les orientations sont prises conformément à la loi? C'est tout.
Ok, quand on regarde ce que va faire les conseillers régionaux, en tout cas, ils relèvent des départements, non? C'est les représentants départementaux qui font...
Nous avons les délégués départementaux et nous avons ceux du commandement traditionnel. Voilà. Nous avons les délégués départementaux et ceux issus du commandement traditionnel. Voilà. Donc voilà, c'est comme ça que est composé dans le conseil.
Commandement traditionnel, ici dans le littoral.
Il y a 20 places pour le commandement traditionnel.
Ici,
et ils sont par département.
Ici, dans le littoral.
Dans le littoral.
Quelle est la différence alors? Qu'est-ce qui fait la différence? On dit qu'il y a House of Chiefs.
Qu'est-ce qui fait le plus-value même?
La différence, c'est que la House of Chiefs, dans le statut spécial, statue pratiquement en délibération de seconde lecture de tout ce qui est fait à la Chambre basse. Par contre, dans les 8 autres régions. Voilà. Dans le cadre des 8 autres régions où il n'y a pas le statut spécial, tous les conseillers régionaux, qu'ils soient des délégués départementaux ou bien issus du commandement traditionnel, ils le sont en assemblée générale et statut dans le cadre de la délégation.
Comme à l'Assemblée nationale, on dit que si des House of Divisional Representatives are not okay with what the House of Chiefs are saying, they establish and they move forward exactly like what obtains at the Senate. So finally, what are they doing? Because they cannot cause a change in what are they.
Is talking too
Non, non, le, voilà. Le, non, non, c'est pas pour le bloquer.
Il n'y a pas de problème.
Oui, oui, moi je voudrais dire que au Cameroun, on essaie d'expliquer ce qui est inexplicable. Et je veux vous le dire, en réalité, le Cameroun est le seul pays au monde où tout va à l'envers. Donc, quand quelqu'un veut construire sa maison au Cameroun, c'est ce que veut nous apprendre le système gouvernemental de Yaoundé, de Paul Biya en général, que nous subissons en ce moment. Ça veut dire que chez eux, il faut commencer par le toit avant de finir par la fondation. Parce qu'en réalité, lorsque nous regardons même les politiques, les structures même qui sont mises sur pied, les structures qui sont mises sur pied, pour ce qu'ils disent, ce qu'ils appellent pour implémenter la décentralisation. Mais regardez ces structures, ce sont des structures moribondes. Ce sont juste des pantins qu'on a mis là-bas, allez vous débrouiller, attendez. Moi, je vais vous prendre un cas palpable. Regardez par exemple, n'est-ce pas, les élections se sont déroulées également dans le littoral. Où est le siège, par exemple, des régionaux qui ont été votés? Le président est où? Vous voyez que on a pensé d'abord aux hommes sans avoir mis sur pied la structure elle-même. Donc, ils sont là. Quand il se lève le matin, il est chez lui, il attend le coup de fil. S'il y a peut-être un marché, il y a un gombo, il s'en va prendre. C'est de ça qu'il est question en réalité. Et c'est ce que nous vivons dans toutes les régions au Cameroun. On nous a mis un truc là pour nous dire que ok, on est en train de mettre sur pied d'implémenter la décentralisation. Mais or que c'est faux. Moi je vois que c'est pour résoudre plutôt un autre problème. Un autre problème qui est lequel? Qui est celui de la pression des organisations internationales qui mettent pression sur le gouvernement de Yaoundé en leur disant mais attendez, nous ne sommes plus à l'époque coloniale. Parce qu'au Cameroun, ce qu'on applique encore aujourd'hui, c'est le système exactement colonial. On veut nous maintenir dans un système où vous n'avez pas le droit de parole. Tout ce que vous devez faire au quotidien doit être contrôlé par quelqu'un. C'est pourquoi lorsque vous allez lever la tête, on va vouloir multiplier autour de vous un certain nombre de personnes pour vous contrecarrer, pour vous cadenasser davantage. Vous pensez que, regardez par exemple, je vais prendre un exemple palpable, au nord-ouest et au sud-ouest. Les délégués régionaux sont là. Le président régional même est là. Mais depuis, ça fait bientôt 3, 4, 5 mois. Qu'est-ce qu'ils font? Qu'est-ce qu'ils sont même en réalité devenus? Vous avez vu un papier un jour que ces délégués ont signé ou bien ces présidents ont signé?
J'ai vu. I saw the president of the House of Chiefs in the Northwest signing a funeral announcement for one of the.
Mais non, quand je parle d'un document signé.
Let's have respect for those people. That's humiliating. Very humiliating.
No, of course, I'm saying that this is the only document I've seen.
On parle même. C'est ça.
Announcement.
C'est ce à quoi on veut réduire en réalité ces différentes institutions. Vous êtes juste là pour vous occuper de ce qu'un copanéliste a appelé tout à l'heure et suer les fesses des gens. Mais c'est de ça qu'il est question. On ne vous met pas là pour que vous travaillez. Parce qu'en réalité, s'il fallait implémenter la décentralisation au Cameroun et implémenter par ricochet le statut spécial dans le nord-ouest ou le sud-ouest, moi je m'attendais à ce qu'au lendemain de cette implémentation, qu'on nous dise par exemple que le gouverneur n'existe plus et que peut-être le sous-préfet est parti, que le préfet même en réalité n'est plus là, parce qu'il y a une institution qui est venue remplacer, parce que c'est ça même le contenu de ces structures qu'on met sur pied. Mais regardez aujourd'hui, les mairies même qui existent depuis fort longtemps. Je lisais un rapport de la Chambre des comptes il y a deux jours, où on nous dit que 93% de communes au Cameroun ne peuvent pas fournir un rapport même financier de ce qu'ils ont fait pendant tout un mandat. Et je me suis demandé, mais pourquoi? Juste parce qu'à côté des mairies, on leur a envoyé des secrétaires dans les mairies, on leur a envoyé les comptables qui sont des fonctionnaires. Et donc cela ne permet pas aux maires même de se mouvoir dans leurs fonctions. Ils n'ont même pas cette liberté de pouvoir implémenter des actions pour améliorer les conditions de vie de leur population. Et même, il faudrait pas qu'on reste. Mais le RDP, c'est aujourd'hui, nous amène dans des discours laudateurs qui ils font dormir nos esprits pour nous dire que non, nous implémentons, mais en réalité, il n'en est rien.
Just quickly add before you change the course of discussion. When he talked about non-overlapping of functions, the law on regional and local authority says that in section 271, that the regional councils shall create, equip, manage and maintain government schools and high schools.
Voilà.
That they shall recruit and manage the teaching and support staff of these institutions. So what then will be the role of the regional delegates?
Voilà.
Just leave this one.
Yeah, but recruitment.
No, you recruit and you manage. And you recruit staff. The same thing with this
policy. L'éducation.
Non, mais monsieur, nous faire la politique de l'éducation. C'est que qu'on vous donne un cahier de charge en haut et que ici en bas, comme vous êtes le président régional, que c'est vous qui vous chargez de l'implémentation.
Le ministre to create the policy.
The ministry does the policies in Yaoundé and then the
at regional level they apply.
They apply. So regional delegates, what then would be their function?
Don't worry.
Mais le délégué régional est là. Il est le représentant du ministre en ce qui concerne la question.
Quel sera donc son rôle?
And they say that the governor, the representative of the state, represents all ministers, all ministries. The governor of a region represents all the ministries of that region. Mm-hmm. Exactly. So why then do you have another regional delegate representing the minister when there's a governor who represents all of those people? That's duplication. No, I think that we have gone past this stage of duplication of functions.
I'm coming. Now let's look at the House of Chiefs, because in his special status, he said, "Yeah, la chambre, oh, la chambre."
Yes,
yes, but
est-ce qu'on a besoin de ça?
Ici, il y a aussi le chambre.
Non. C'est n'est que au niveau du statut spécial du Nord-Ouest et du Sud-Ouest.
The house that comprises the chiefs.
Ici, c'est des commissions. Des commissions. Il y a l'assemblée du conseil régional.
Where are the chiefs? The chiefs are.
Ils sont tous considérés comme des conseillers régionaux.
Ok.
Ici.
Now, I want us to look at the House of Chiefs here. It says, the House of Chiefs shall comprise 20 members from among traditional rulers elected in accordance with the laws in force. The House of Chiefs shall rule on all matters falling within the powers of the Regional Assembly. It shall give its opinion on the following issues. The status of the traditional chiefdom. I don't know how that would function. Is that not also coming? Is that not also the duty of the
Minister of
Territorial Administration? Then, secondly, the management and conservation of historical sites, monuments, and vestiges. That's also Ministry of
Arts and Culture.
The organization of cultural and traditional events in the region, and then the collection and translation of elements of oral tradition. That is what. The House of Chiefs.
No, I mean the House of Chiefs in charge of culture, tradition. You would take somebody who has gone to school, because he's a traditional ruler, you reduce him to cultures, to tradition, to status of chiefdoms and fundums, where he has something to offer the nation. I have said this special status, this Cameroon government, I'm very, very sincere, it's like the shape of a camel. A camel is the most shapeless animal in the world. It has a torso of a cow behind. It has a leg of an elephant. It has a neck of a giraffe. It has a mouth of a hippopotamus. This government copies things from other countries. I want to ask that, who is their role model in special status? Because they must have copied it from somewhere. I know 14 nations and 121 regions in the world that practice special status, but Cameroon has nothing in resemblance with those 121 regions. It has nothing with the 14 nations. France happens to be our own colonial master, and we're the one trying to introduce a special status here. Has 7 regions in France that enjoy special status. Britain has 7 regions. Russia has 26 regions that enjoy special status. China has 6 regions that enjoy special status. But none of those special status reflect what we have here. That's why when Arthur is a cacophony, I am 100% behind it. Because you don't go and begin. Then the only thing that has happened in the past is that the name of government delegate has been changed to city mayor. You know that word? The special status came to maintain position and to change names. In order to satisfy some disgruntled individuals in North and Southwest, they have created offices to put them inside so they could be paying them for a job they are not doing. Because I think that they have added more offices when there is no job. Check all these recent offices. There is nothing this special status or these so-called offices created are coming to do that the other offices have been in place were not doing it. What is culture? Under the Minister of Culture, they are telling us that if there are going to be 20 classrooms, Massa, even a principal can do that one now. C'est la politique d'éducation. So education has another politics apart from the normal politics we are running. There's a delegate of secondary education, delegate of basic education who carries out those responsibilities. Then we are now creating a commissioner for education to come and occupy. That's why I say we should dismantle this thing and go back to the federal system, because this one is costlier than the federal system. We used to have two persons occupy one office in the two different regions. Then we have now six persons occupying one office in these regions that we are creating. Creating what kind of job? They say the chiefs, as a matter of fact, because they are chiefs, their lives are circling all around culture. Responsibilities that before these chiefs ever came as a House of Chiefs, the Ministry of Culture was running it smoothly. How do you explain that Magufuli comes to power? There are 30 ministers, he reduces them to 19. Then we are increasing offices in a country where the bodies never need to pay the people. We used to have Ministry of Territorial Administration and Decentralization. We have broken it down to Territorial Administration and Decentralization. Under the decentralization, we are creating offices again and more responsibility when there's no money to manage the people. I think we should be sincere with the issue of special status. The whole thing is a drama. And to even consider the fact that it was used to appease the Northwest and Southwest to curb the Anglophone crisis, they are instead igniting more problems. Because the people who have been appointed and they have no responsibility, they will be the next bone of contention that the government will face. So the next phase of AMBA is coming through this regional offices that they have created and they have kept people in the air. To think of it, people are taken from Minister of Territorial Administration and appointed as Secretary Generals in councils. It will shock you that there's a mayor and the Secretary General of a mayor, is someone who left Enam and has stayed under the Minister of Territorial Administration. There is no job. And then he's appointed as Secretary General to a council because he couldn't find a job. Now, if they are taking people who are trained from Enam to come and run councils, where are the individuals who were elected? Then we are now creating more of it. The Commission of Education, chiefs are there to do what?
Take your artifacts.
and museums. Oh God! I see we even have the museums.
Yeah, but the organization of cultural and traditional events in the region. Let's assume that the Ngondo is organized by the Douala chiefs. We have in Lela Festival in
Bali.
In the littoral region, we have Mpo, that is organized by the Basas. Is it now the House of Chiefs that are now going to organize this?
Non, faut c'est-à-dire que les uns les autres sont en train de créer l'amalgame là où il n'y en a pas. On vous dit par exemple que vous n'avez pas lu par exemple les dispositions de l'article 338 qui suivent. Okay. La House of Chiefs dispose de deux commissions. C'est pour vous montrer que son champ est aussi élargi qu'au niveau même de tout le Conseil.
C'est l'article...
L'article 30, qui suit.
The Committee on Administrative and Legal Affairs and Standing Orders, Education, Health,
exactement.
Population, the Committee on Finances, Infrastructure Planning, Economic Development.
Okay. Donc, ça voudrait dire que ne cantonnez pas la House of Chiefs seulement aux affaires culturelles et des manifestations d'ordre culturel. Elle a compétence sur tous les volets, sur le plan infrastructurel, des finances, de la santé, des affaires sociales et culturelles, de la jeunesse et des sports, ainsi de suite.
But he can never become regional president. Mais, the law is clear that the traditional ruler can never become regional president.
Yeah, they play the role of the vice.
In the special status.
On vous dit
so
que,
they have been,
on vous dit que
a second federal.
Lorsque le bureau exécutif a besoin de soumettre pour délibération, c'est d'abord étudié dans le cadre des commissions. Et ces commissions-là, qui sont donc spécialisées, vont donc maintenant amender ces propositions, ensuite maintenant proposer à l'Assemblée générale pour adoption. Et on vous dit que les conseils régionaux fonctionnent sur la base des délibérations prises par l'ensemble des conseillers régionaux. C'est de ça dont il s'agit.
Section 345. Sub 4 says all deliberations, since you are talking about deliberations, all the deliberations adopted by the regional assembly shall be forwarded to the representative of the state.
For what?
No. C'est-à-dire, le représentant de l'État a pour vocation à vérifier que l'ensemble des décisions qui sont prises par les conseils régionaux sont conformes à la loi.
Okay.
Et voici ce qui est dit. Il a son avis à émettre des propositions, il trouve des propositions et tout.
Sauf qu'à Baganté, le préfet a renvoyé maintes fois les élections du maire. Parce que la bataille qu'il y avait autour ne correspondait pas à ses aspirations. Et maintenant, lorsqu'il n'a pas une voix prépondérante, est-ce qu'il devrait donc stopper ça?
Non,
donc nous comprenons que le représentant de l'État au sein de cette commission, c'est pour davantage...
Non, là encore, vous êtes en train soit de faire de mauvaise foi, c'est la loi.
Monsieur Youfis, il va finir de parler, maintenant c'est...
Je n'avais même pas fini de développer ce que je
t'ai dit. Non, tu avais fini, tu répondais, c'était pas toi non, monsieur Youfis.
Ok.
Mais vous avez parlé, lui il a parlé, vous répétez sans que les autres...
D'accord, oui, j'étais juste en train de dire que ce que le préfet de est conforme à la loi.
Ati, you look through what traditional rulers are expected to do, does it give them the powers that they had before now when the House of Chiefs existed before the dissolution of the federal system?
Well, I think that they have just gone ahead to water down the traditions of the people. Because in the past, a chief is a sacred being. Somebody who communicates is an interlocutor between the gods and the living. How then does he go to an election and is beaten? How can we even imagine that somebody who communicates with the gods will contest an election and is beaten? Or that will submit his files and make errors? How can we comprehend that somebody who has contact with God, the gods, will make errors, clerical errors? So I think that this is the special status is not in what people are trying to present. That House of Chiefs, they will give second reading, or like Senate. And no, that's not what we need. What we need is for the 15% of the state budget to be sent to the regional councils, not only to the Northwest and Southwest regions, to all the councils. That if you share that money out, it will be 2.1 billion francs per council. So if each council takes that money, they can develop their localities and provide water and electricity and everything. That is what we want. All this issue of position, of creating people who don't even know what is happening. People went for election without even having a roadmap. And today they are crying in front of ministers, oh, money is not coming, oh, computers are coming in French. Oh, when they were being elected, what was their roadmap? What did they set out to achieve? They set out to achieve nothing. And I think that we should stay on the law. The important issues in the special status have not been addressed. The special status for me, for Northwest and Southwest, because it says that it shall take into consideration the specific organizational and operational regime.
Yes.
And these elections came at a very crucial moment in the life of the Northwest and Southwest regions. So those who had said that there were problems in Northwest and Southwest regions should have been the ones to be co-opted into the system in a special status regime, not like people, the other regions were electing and using party system to elect people to come and fill positions. They should have used a special status regime to bring in people like Agobala, for example, who had said there were problems in the common law system. They bring them in to identify those problems, because section 328 of this law says that they shall participate in the formulation of national public policies, that they shall also participate in the setting up and management of regional development authorities, that they shall participate in the formulation of national public policy relating to the Anglophone educational subsystem, and that they shall be consulted when they are developing law legal issues in the country. So since the role is to contribute to education, people like Professor Abangma and other of SINES and all those trade unions in the Northern and Southwest regions should have been the ones in these people who said there were problems, and the regional councils and special status is out to solve these problems. They should have brought them in. You cannot bring in somebody who said there was no problem. And even when President Bia admitted that there's a problem and called a meeting to solve it, these people are yet to apologize for claiming that there was no problem. And in the event where they had not even admitted that there was a problem, they were now elected. Well, let's assume they were elected. And met to be in charge of solving a problem that they did not acknowledge existed. So I think that there's zero expectation from this kind of structure, because the special status was not extended to bring in the people who said there was a problem, who proposed measures to solve this problem, and some of them were even arrested and locked up. These are the people that should have been on board. Me, I see former civil administrators. These are people who were championing, the discourse that there was no problem. And today you bring them to solve the problem. What problem? And if the problem was on the common law system, if the second problem was on the educational system, and the law says in section 328 that for the special status in the northern and southwest regions, they shall propose the formulation of policies relating to the Anglo-Saxon educational system. Have they done so? That they shall also propose laws and the common law system and everything. They have not done so. The sticky issues that brought about this crisis have not been addressed. When Mancho BBC took to the streets, he was talking about the neglect of the city of Bamenda. If he went beyond later on, but the main issue was about development, that the roads in Bamenda and I saw, and till date, those roads are still, they are even worse than in 2016 when the protest started. And section 328 says that the setting up and management of regional development authorities, it means that structures like Soweda, structures like the Northwest Development Authority should be under the regional councils. But we have not seen that taking shape. So it means the head of state has to personally, because it shows that if he doesn't come on board personally, his ministers are going to fail us. So he should take the commitment and come on board and sign a decree or the text of application or whatever to see that the decentralization process takes place. Okay. Even if he means looking for Ghana must go backs and carrying the 15%, the billions in the back, and taking to the regional council and sharing to them that take this the money, develop your communities. Leo, I'm saying that this 2.1 billion, when you share it, it's going to give 10 kilometers of road per subdivision every year.
Okay,
that's what we are losing.
Ndifor Richard, I will read the powers of the president and vice of the regional executive council. He says he is expected to manage the property of the region and monitor such management, particularly with regards to movement on such property, subject to the duties devolving to the representative of the state and mayors. So he has a lot of work to do, but we still find many of them complaining. Is it to say that they were unaware of what was expected from them before they took office? Or like Atia Tilaris raised, they had no roadmap for what they had as plans for the regions?
Leonard, my perspective is this law per se, the law as we see, if it stays the way it is, and then we have the same structure as we have it, I don't see what kind of magic we are going to use to effectively implement things. All of this thing boils down to the fact that the regime is not willing to bow out. I can't just say there that the BIA should come on the ground and whatsoever. We keep giving this impression that President Biya does not know what is happening. He knows exactly what is happening. He knows all these guys that are acting around, they're acting on his behalf. He knows all these things that's happening. These are facts that are just hooked up and sent down to the people. We should not pretend it as if, oh, the president does not know. There are people who are coming and doing it, who are doing that. It is all of these are their plans. They know all of these things. And all of these steps from the fact they are determined not to dissolve power to the local authorities. They don't want power to go down there. They only pay lip service to this idea of decentralization. As a matter of fact, this regime does not believe in anything that would take even the least power from their hands. This is why when they put this law, they go somewhere and then they twist it and say, oh, they talk about this thing of supervisory authority. They talk about this thing of the governor comes to do all the time. If they are determined, who are these governors? Are they made by the people that they are appointed? Are they created differently from the people who are elected? Why don't we trust the people who are elected? Why do we keep thinking that it is only those people who they are as appointed, who has the all-knowing, they're all-knowing, who can be able to do it, who are so good that they cannot be corrupt? If they are trust the people he appoints, why don't he trust the people Cameroonians elected? Cameroonians elected him and placed there. He should trust Cameroonians to elect right people to run. run and manage the local councils. So all of this thing, if we have to be serious about this whole thing, there is one way. When I said earlier that we have to go back to the drawing board, you're asking me, I'm going back to the drawing board. We have to go back. We have to, this whole thing will not work. We must go back to federalism. That is what it entails, because how do you, how, I keep asking this question. Because all this commission, I hear the CPDM guy who is there explaining things, and it sounds to me like they are doing the work that some commission and the regional delegation of education were doing. It just sounds like the regional delegate just set up a commission of people within his delegation, and they'll do exactly that work that they are saying that these guys are going to do, and they'll even do it better. So all of this thing with a set structure, with this structure of ministries, regional delegate, divisional delegate, and all of that in place, and then say we are having some regional authorities or regional council, whatever, all of that will overlap. There's no way we try to twist it. Look at the way our guy there from the CPDM is trying to twist things and trying to give responsibilities where the CPDM exists. What would they be doing? And I like the question they keep asking him. What differently could this people be doing when the other people, the delegation, was not doing? What is it they'll be doing that the delegation was not doing? They cannot answer that question, because all of these things just report around that, and then they pick a few people, compensate them, give them money to occupy offices and do nothing. It's absolutely nothing. So as a matter of fact, we can talk about this law from now to thy kingdom come, but that law, with the structure as it is, as we have now, will not work. So that if we have to apply that law, then maybe we'll have to dissolve all those regional delegations and all of that for all these things to work perfectly. And then we also need to, these guys also, the regional council, whatever, if they want to maintain the so-called regional council, they need to have autonomy, financial autonomy. They need to have a budget. There need to be some kind of a method put in place as to how they will share the revenues between the local councils and the central government. If we sit here expecting a certain 15% to be cut in the bank to come and give the local councils and all of that to run, it will still boil down to the same thing. It is coming, it is down there, running everything down here. So as a matter of fact, we have a real problem, and until we admit that our administrative structure, the way our governance, our the Cameroon administrative system is functioning, is not okay. And that needs to be open to look at another alternative, which we have said is the federalism. When they talk of special status, I thought they could use the Northwest and Southwest as a pilot, as pilot region, to see how the federal system works well within this region, and then they can copy from that and apply it to the other region. But apparently, they are not ready to even leave this region with the least power, or to even allow least power to be their own day to come down to the local. So there is no will. The will is not there. If we are dreaming that all of this law and all of that will create some situation where we will have the local authorities having the power that we expect them to have, we're only wasting our time.
Okay.
That will lead to the gang.
Okay, Ndifo, thank you there. Mais, qu'est-ce qui empêche ces présidents et les conseillers régionaux d'entrer dans la danse? Est-ce qu'ils doivent attendre qu'il y ait des les demandes que faites ceci et ne pas faire cela? Qu'est-ce qu'ils attendent? Parce que depuis qu'ils ont été élus, on attend rien d'eux.
Justement, si nous notons cette absence de ces conseils régionaux qui ont été mis sur pied, c'est justement parce qu'en réalité, au moment où ces gens arrivent sur la scène, je dirais même politique, ou alors sur la scène de la gestion de la chose politique, ils n'ont réellement pas de cahier de charges. Ils savent qu'ils seront des conseillers régionaux. Mais ils ne connaissent... Bon, peut-être ils peuvent avoir, pour ceux qui ont été à l'école, une certaine connaissance en ce qui concerne le rôle même d'un conseil régional. Mais du point de vue matériel, ils ne connaissent pas en réalité ce qu'on attend d'eux au Cameroun. Parce que, moi, je vais vous dire une chose. Lorsque moi, je dirige une entreprise, quand je vous appelle et que je vous nomme comme directeur général. Je vous dis, bon, voilà ce que j'attends de vous. Et maintenant, lorsque nous lisons des différents textes qui ont été apprêtés pour accueillir ou bien qui servent de cahier des charges à ces conseils régionaux, à ces conseillers régionaux, alors, mais pourquoi ce qui est dit dans les textes n'est pas immédiatement appliqué au moment où ils arrivent? Moi, j'ai vu, je disais tout à l'heure que depuis qu'ils sont là, montre-moi un seul texte où un président régional a signé. Montre-moi des actions que ceux-là ont entreprises qui vont dans le sens de l'amélioration des conditions de vie.
Ou alors, proactifs.
Non, mais ils ne peuvent pas être proactifs. Parce qu'en réalité, ils sont dans un enclos. On les a pris, jetés dans un enclos fermé, mettre autour d'eux un ensemble de conditions même qui ne leur permettent pas de faire même des sorties médiatiques. Parce que je suis certain que si dans certaines régions, on aurait donné à ces conseillers régionaux la latitude de parler, certainement vous aurez compris des choses terribles.
J'ai eu à parler avec beaucoup. Je voulais qu'ils soient ici, donc, ils ont refusé.
Je dis dans certaines régions. Okay. Parce qu'il y a certains là qui sont du parti au pouvoir, qui veut nous maintenir dans cette mouvance coloniale d'il y a des milliers d'années. Oui, quand ils seront ici, ils ne diront rien. Mais nous côtoyons au quotidien des personnalités de cette République, nous côtoyons des conseillers régionaux qui nous disent qu'en réalité, depuis qu'ils sont élus, ils sont assis chez eux, ils attendent qu'on appelle pour leur dire « Ok, voilà ce que tu dois faire demain. » Mais en réalité, si cette structure donc est considérée comme telle, comme des pantins, comme des personnes qui sont assises et attendent qu'un jour, qu'on dise « Ok, voilà un papier, maintenant tu peux le signer. » Quelle était donc la plus-value de mettre toutes ces structures sur pied? Il fallait donc qu'on nous dise que nous restons dans notre état centralisé où tout vient de Yaoundé et que nous décidons de ce qui va se passer au quotidien de la vie des Camerounais. Mais si nous avons accepté de mettre toutes ces structures sur pied, c'est parce que nous avons voulu déconjectionner même la gestion de l'affaire, la gestion de la société camerounaise. Mais nous n'observons pas ça sur le terrain. Ces gens sont là, ils n'ont rien à faire, ils se tournent les pouces. D'ailleurs, moi je dis même que si je m'en vais emprunter le discours de mon président, le président honorable Kabla Libi, qui dit que en réalité, ces gens servent à quoi? Il avait même dit quelque part qu'il devait, s'il arrivait à prendre le pouvoir, il devait enlever le Sénat parce qu'ils ne savent pas à quoi ils servent. Mais en réalité, si ces personnes donc, si ces structures, ces conseils régionaux que nous avons mis sur pied sont existentiels et que sur le terrain, nous continuons à voir plutôt le gouverneur décider sur la gestion des choses. D'ailleurs, à Douala Premier, nous sommes dans la ville, à Douala Premier, où un maire a dit un jour que voilà, dans le cadre de ma compétence, je vais désinfecter une école. On lui a dit à Yaoundé que monsieur, arrêtez ça. Okay. Vous partez désinfecter une école que c'est de votre... Et c'est ça, le reflet même de la politique gouvernementale au Cameroun. Nous sommes là, les gens sont votés, ils sont votés et c'est les populations qui ont choisi ces personnes. Oui. Mais ces personnes qui arrivaient sur les lieux n'ont pas la latitude de se mouvoir.
Monsieur Yu, now many persons are really asking the question, what the essence of the special status is, because they have waited and seemingly these guys are not coming down to tell them what it's all about. And I was asking him why they are not playing proactive instead of waiting for people to start asking questions. Why are they not going down to meet the people and explain the essence or the contents of what we are struggling to make them understand here? Why are they still in their offices? Ils ont peur de quoi?
Non, il y a aucune peur. Je constate tout simplement qu'il y a une méconnaissance des actions des conseils régionaux actuellement. Je vous l'accorde, vous. Et déjà, lorsque vous dites que le PCR ne trouve pas l'utilité de ce, pourtant vous étiez à ces élections et que vous avez perdu, on se demande bien que vous étiez en train d'aller à ces élections-là. Pourquoi?
Bon,
pour revenir à la réalité, pour revenir à la réalité, les conseils régionaux ont été installés le 22 janvier. Oui. À cette date-là, le gouvernement de la République avait déjà son budget. À cette date-là, les communes d'arrondissement avaient déjà leur budget, les mairies des villes avaient déjà leur budget. Mais les conseils régionaux doivent arriver et prendre la main en ce qui concerne un certain nombre de compétences qui leur sont transférées, en ce qui concerne la collaboration avec l'État pour pouvoir préparer les transferts des compétences et des ressources. C'est un travail de fond.
2023.
Moi, je ne parle pas de 2023. On est en train de dire que depuis le 22 janvier,
le gouvernement décide de mettre une structure sur pied. On dit que bon, pendant qu'ils seront mis sur pied, c'est dans 3 ans que vous allez commencer le travail.
S'il vous plaît, when you are talking, nobody cuts you now. But
ok, je suis en train de vouloir expliquer que si, par exemple, vous avez vu l'apparition sans publicité du Cameroun Tribune du 3 mai 2021, ils ont présenté un bilan de ce que les conseils régionaux ont déjà commencé à faire depuis leurs 100 premiers jours. Vous avez vu, par exemple, au niveau des sièges, l'ensemble des conseils régionaux sont localisés maintenant, ils ont des sièges provisoires, parce que après les conseils régionaux vont construire leurs immeubles sièges. Mais pour pouvoir construire leurs immeubles sièges, il fallait par exemple un transfert du domaine privé, public, vers le domaine régional. Ça fait partie de la collaboration avec les ministères qu'il faut le faire, parce que vous ne pouvez pas construire là où la terre ne vous appartient pas encore. Il y a 73 compétences qui sont prévues par la loi. Et maintenant, ils sont en train de travailler de manière conjointe avec l'ensemble de ces ministères-là pour que ces compétences, en termes de compétences et de ressources, ces ressources sont déjà budgétisées dans le budget des ministères. Il faudrait que la compétence et les ressources soient transférées. Mais il y a ce qu'on appelle les budgets de démarrage pour le fonctionnement. Et je vous ai dit que pour pouvoir parler d'une mise en œuvre, ça ne se passe pas comme si vous faites du dilatoire. On ne construit pas une route en disant « je m'en vais boudonner là-bas » tout simplement. On construit une route avec toutes les études de faisabilité, avec toutes les études préalables, y compris maintenant la disponibilité des financements. C'est ce qui est en train d'être fait aujourd'hui. Donc moi, je ne suis même pas du tout inquiet en ce qui concerne la mise en route, les feuilles de route et l'atteinte même des objectifs des conseils aujourd'hui, parce que ce que je suis en train de voir aujourd'hui, c'est formidable. C'est des plans qui sont incroyables, mais on ne peut pas en parler ici tout de suite. Vous savez pourquoi? Parce qu'en réalité, c'est après délibération des conseils régionaux que les exécutifs mettent maintenant en exécution. Et nous allons bientôt connaître, dans les tout prochains jours, la convocation des sessions des conseils régionaux, où ces conseils régionaux vont maintenant délibérer sur les projets de budget. Le projet de budget, je vous ai dit que c'est un budget programme. De ce budget programme, il découle un certain nombre de documents qui ont été écrits et élaborés durant ces 100 premiers jours. C'est ce que les uns et les autres ne savent pas. Je vous ai dit par exemple qu'actuellement, l'ensemble des conseils régionaux ont la vision du développement de la région. Et c'est à partir de cette vision du développement de la région qu'un exécutif déroule son plan d'action. Actuellement, l'ensemble des conseils régionaux ont leur plan régional de développement. Les schémas directeurs d'aménagement du territoire également, parce que quand vous devriez, par exemple, parler des logements sociaux, parler des écoles, parler des hôpitaux, vous devez vous rassurer qu'il n'y a pas des incompatibilités. Je vous prends un exemple. Si vous voulez, vous venez construire un lycée, là où il y a une exploitation probable du pétrole, ça voulait dire que vous n'avez pas bien regardé. Vous devez regarder sur le plan des sols. Est-ce que ici on va exploiter du pétrole? Alors ce ne sera pas un lieu où vous allez mettre votre établissement. Vous vérifiez tous ces éléments avant de lancer. Je dis que tous les conseils aujourd'hui sont en train de travailler sur la base de ce qu'elles sont en train de mesurer. Donc, ce qui était avant, vous allez demander cela aux structures qui étaient antérieures. Mais maintenant, soyons patients juste. Ça ne fait que 100 jours. Ça ne fait que 100 jours.
Est-ce que j'ai demandé que les lycées qui étaient déjà établis, qui avaient vérifié le sol, s'il y avait le pétrole ou le manganèse ou l'or ou le diamant.
Je suis en train de vous dire que si aujourd'hui, on n'a pas encore cassé un lycée pour besoin d'exploitation minière et tout, ça voudrait dire que nous donnons au moins la caution que toutes ces études au préalable ont été faites.
Vous savez que nous avons presque
cassé le lycée au Cameroun. On a cassé une école primaire à Yaoundé.
Oui, mais je suis donc en train de vous dire que toutes ces études préalables sont faites par les conseils régionaux aujourd'hui. Et Moi, je suis confiant que, et autre chose encore, on a dit que nous, le Cameroun est un État unitaire et décentralisé. Nous n'avons pas encore fini d'éprouver la décentralisation. Elle vient d'être parachevée par la mise en place de la dernière structure de la décentralisation. Nous sommes à 100 jours, tout simplement, et pour un mandat de 5 ans, mais donnons du temps à ces conseils régionaux de travailler et de dire maintenant que, OK, cette décentralisation, par rapport aux attentes et à la feuille de route, ça n'a pas marché ou pas. On fait un faux procès ici aujourd'hui.
You are raising an issue which is which could be pertinent because you say many persons are ignorant of what the law says. But now you are struggling to tell the people what the law says. What are the persons in question? We are talking about the key actors. Let's assume that they don't have the money to engage in the tarring of roads and other things. Just to inform the people, what stops them from explaining these things that we are saying? They have 100 days. What if they took 1 month? That this 1 month is to sensitize the people. What stops them from doing that? Don't communicate.
That's the same reason why we have a challenge with COVID-19 in Cameroon, because the communication is very poor. They are poor, don't even know if COVID-19 exists, because they have a very poor communication system. To conclude there, Mr. Liu, what makes this whole special status a fake is that you will never see an Englishman a governor in Quebec. That is, if they are giving Quebec a special status, it should be a native of Quebec that heads Quebec. The fact that Ocala Bilai, a francophone governor, is heading a state that has been given special status concludes that the whole special status is a farce.
Yeah, maybe it's because he was governor in time of crisis. Maybe
he was governor in times of crisis, and yes, the special status had been given, that automatically kicks him out of
crisis. The crisis has still there.
Who made him the messiah to solve the crisis? Number two,
Cameroon is a unity state.
It's a unity state.
Cameroonians can work anywhere in the
country. No, that is a mistake you are making.
He's a Cameroonian.
Because it is a special status. Listen to me, because it's a special status.
It's not about the fact that he's francophone.
If you have studied special status, clearly, it is giving a people their rights, a certain level of autonomy. And if a man from another region is not supposed, to a greater extent, the native of certain communities are the ones that are supposed to serve as senators in that community, because they understand the very problem of the people. A man cannot be from another region, and a particular region is giving the special status. You never go to New Mongolia and you see a man from Beijing, governor.
This law says so. The law says that you must be from the region to become a regional president.
That is
it. He must be from the region to become a city mayor.
Yeah, but
the law is clear on that.
Okay, the law is clear on that.
All of those things.
What is a governor doing in a place where there's an executive regional president?
The law does not call them governors. The law says representative of the state. So President Bia, who appoints his representatives, can appoint anybody.
So, so we don't have governors anymore.
When you read the constitution of the country, they give the head of state sweeping powers. He can decide and undecide. He appoints to civil and military positions. Nobody is in contest with the head of state's prerogatives.
Nobody.
What we are of interest here is that they should give us our Anglo-Saxon culture. It should be preserved. The common law should be preserved. And development should be seen in the northwest and southwest region.
Then they should
wipe that is done.
But wait, they should wipe that word special status, because it's an abuse of the whole concept. They should never mention the word special status. Because if other countries hear that word mentioned in Cameroon here, and we are not doing what it deserves, then we are abusing the whole concept. They should call it something else, not special status, because as far as special status is concerned, that name should be wiped out. They should call it Jangi status, call it Panorama status, put something there. Don't put special status, because if the special status from all strata of life, that thing does not tie in bandits.
Okay, I think that like Atia said, a Cameroonian is supposed to serve wherever they are called upon to serve.
I'm not against that.
But they should stop the special status name. Yeah, but my media prime also will not take responsibility for saying that a francophone and an anglophone should not work. I think
it's not part of
our editorial
policy. We are not saying that. Nobody said that yet. You are misconstruing the whole truth. I'm saying that if they are using the word special status,
yeah,
they should wipe that word special status, because in the actual context,
I'm sure the anglophones who are serving in the littoral, they are working in the littoral region and in other regions. So
We are dealing with special status here, please. Special status here. I'm not trying to bring division.
I don't want that to make.
In special status. If you stop the special status concept very well, then it is wrongly applied here.
Le statut spécial n'est pas sur les hommes. Okay. Il est sur les compétences.
Have you landed? Apostle.
No, I've landed.
On a oublié les apologies.
Let me get to Ndifo. I will with you. I always read what the law says. The law says, that the participation of the representative of the state and or his duly authorized representative at regional assembly meetings shall be as of right whenever he so requests. The representative of the state or his duly authorized representative shall be heard, but may neither vote nor chair the regional assembly. His statements shall be recorded in the minutes of the proceedings. I'm sure Atia have raised that already. Section 349.1 says, in January following the end of the financial year, the representative of the state shall present a star report, shall be discussed in his presence. Is this to say that to some extent here, the representative of the state is rendering account to the regional assembly members?
Leonard, I want to leave it to you in the mic to me. I've been trying to get the mic. When Atia, and the way you guys are putting it, like nobody's saying that a Francophone cannot carry on administrative responsibility in Northwest and Southwest region. Our interest here is the fact that we have something they call the special status. In that special status, it is clearly stated in the law. It is stated there that executive powers is in the hands of the regional president. That's what is in the law. That's what we just read earlier. So what Professor Ambe, Pastor Apostle Ambe is trying to explain is that if you say somebody is the executive, has the executive authority, allow him manage that. And again, in that same law, they say for you to have that regional authority to be the regional president, you must be somebody from the region. So there are two things there. You must be somebody from the region. Secondly, you have executive authority. So therefore, the position of governor comes null and void. It becomes irrelevant. Except maybe we are not reading this law the way it is. Because if you say somebody is the executive authority or he has executive powers, then what is the use of the governor? The governor has no use. Maybe Pastor, I keep making the mistake of calling him Pastor. Maybe Apostle then made the error of mentioning a name of a governor. But the real thing there is that the position of governor is irrelevant. And even if we need to have a governor who has the executive authority, in that same law that is there, it is not us saying it to discredit your media house. It is paid the law. The law states it should be somebody from the region. That somebody from the region has to have executive powers. So let us base our argument on that. So now coming back to your question, I don't know, Leonard, why you keep reading this law to me, because first of all, the law today does not make any sense to me. Doesn't even have any bearing on the issue of devolution power. I don't see it really devolving power to the local authority. So it doesn't make any sense to me. I don't like to refer to the law. I don't like to even interpret the law in any way. It does not in any way do what it says it wants to do. So as a matter of fact, the law is just, I don't know how to put it, but the law is not relevant if we have to go by what the English and the Anglophones are clamoring for. When the Anglophones are clamoring for, Atia said it, want to the preservation of our own culture. How do we preserve our own culture if we don't have the powers to do that? If the powers are not in our hands, how do you preserve your culture? How do you run the affairs of your own territory when you don't have the power? When everything has to emanate from Yaoundé, and then they push down to our throat, down there at local level. There is no way. So the end goal is for the people of this region to have some degree. And that is why they call it a special status. Special status means they give the people of that area some degree of autonomy. Do we have that degree of autonomy? We don't have it.
You cannot continue to rely on Yaoundé to come and give you a certain 15% and then you want to have autonomy. What kind of autonomy do you have relying on Yaoundé to come and give you a certain 15%? We have to generate income. We have to share with the central government, with Yaoundé, what part of this revenue comes from the local level. What part goes to Yaoundé, what part stay within the local level. We need to agree on that. We need to come to that terms.
Yeah, but what's
when it comes to education, who draws the policy? Who drafts the curriculum? It is Yaoundé that drafts the curriculum and then gives it down to the people of the region to implement. Then of what use is it? If they are the ones to draft the curriculum at the level of Yaoundé and then send it down to us, if they talk of the special status, that the kind of education you come to the Northwest and the Southwest, the kind of education you see there will be different from the education you see in Yaoundé or in the central region or in the littoral region. Because they would have drafted their own curriculum according to their own, Anglo-Saxon method. But now you have the regional delegate who takes authority, who takes information or authority from the minister appointed by Yaoundé. And then the minister tells you this is the policy, these are the curriculums you have to implement in your region. Then how do you now bring in your own Anglophone, Anglo-Saxon education into what the minister has already done in Yaoundé and then send down to the level of the regional delegate? That's the question we should be asking ourselves. Okay. Because this is not all about money. It's not just about the management of money. Yes, the management of money counts. Because it is when you start running the affairs of the state, managing your own money, that you have leverage, you have power to do what you want to do. But because Yaoundé is the one that determines how much money comes to you, you have to rely on Yaoundé.
Okay. Tilaris Atia, we have just 15 minutes to go. I'm sure we are going to do one last round briefly. Is there any way we can make this thing work so well that the people of these two regions can feel that something has been done in their favor?
Yes, just to comment that Nzifo made the error of me saying that they should give 15% as part of special status. No. It is part of the decentralized credits that have to go to the regions. It's national to all the 10 regions. They have to receive the 15%. And I say it should be shared equitably. We have 360 councils in the country, 10 regional councils, and 14 city councils. That gives us a total of 384 councils. And if we have a budget for 2021 of 4,044. No, I'm saying that we have 360 councils.
And les 14 maires de ville.
Yes.
Ajouté, ça fait 374.
Plus the 10 regional councils.
Exactly.
It gives us 384.
44.
384 councils.
That yes, we have. 84. Exactly.
And so voilà. If the budget of 2021 voilà. Is 4,865 billion and you take 15% of that money, it gives us 729 billion. And if you share it out to the 384 councils, you have 2.1 billion each for each of these councils. And I think if we go by the Kona Road report, that a kilometer of road, Tar Road in Cameroon is 205 million to tar 1 kilometer of road. If a council receives 2.1 billion, they can tar 10 kilometers of road per year in all the subdivisions. This does not cancel the other funds that go to councils. This is an extra credit and was agreed upon at the major national dialogue that the state is going to send these resources, and they have not done so. That's what we are talking about. It's not about the special status. And for the special status, for it to work, the spirit and the letter of the law has to be reviewed. Because when you look at Section 328 of that law, it says that in addition to the powers devolved to other regions, the Northwest and Southwest regions shall exercise the following powers. One, it says shall. It means that definitely they have to exercise these powers, shall participate in the formulation of national public policies relating to the Anglophone education system, that it shall participate in setting up and managing regional development authorities, it shall also participate in defining the status of traditional rulers. But then Section 328 sub 2 of this law says that the Northwest and Southwest regions may be consulted on issues relating to the formulation of justice public policies in the common law legal system. These are the fundamental issues that brought the crisis. Why is it may? If you may consult, it means that you can as well not consult them. So it means we are not solving the problem. 328 sub 3 says that they may, that these two regions, Northwest and Southwest regions, may be involved in the management of public services established in their respective territories. So the special status does not hold in this case. It should be total. It should be unconditional. When they start saying may in some cases and they say shall in some cases, there's a tendency that there's bad faith. And when it says in section 329 that the Northwest and Southwest regions shall be administered freely by elected organs, that is the divisional representative, divisional bodies and regional bodies, but that there's this freely shall be under certain conditions. So you cannot be giving and taking. And when the law says that the regional president shall be the chief executive of the region, we should not forget that in companies where there's a chief executive, there's a chairman. So it means that the representative of the state in this case is the chairman, because the law says in section 325 of the law on local and regional and local authorities that if the representative of the state is absent, he can call for a postponement of the regional assembly meeting. Okay. So it means that they have an overbearing influence and they must be present. Okay. And so I think that the government should show good faith and regularize this law. The letter of the law should give us hope. It should tell the people that there are plans for these things to be done. And I don't see the reason why the bureau has two secretaries when we don't have a commissioner for communication. Because the problems that the regional councils are facing is because they are not communicating. The people are in the dark. We are talking about people who were elected without a manifesto. They had no plan. They did not go and tell the masses that if you elect me, we will construct this road. We are going to do the deep sea port and this and that. They had no campaign manifesto. So it means the people cannot judge them. And if they don't communicate as well, things even get worse. You have people, you contact them for interviews, they cannot speak. They meet ministers, they are trembling. And I ask myself, if we are talking about decentralization and cutting down cost, why should the Minister of Local Development leave Yaoundé and come to inaugurate a building in Limbe? What is the role of the regional governors or the regional president? Why can't they be able to do these things and save the cost? Because council workers have not been paid, but the minister's mission allowance will surely be paid at the detriment of the workers who will be paid with this money.
Okay, I see. Yes, qu'est-ce qu'il faut faire pour tourner, je sais pas, faire avancer, to fast track the process?
Justement, il faut d'abord que le gouvernement de Yaoundé reconnaissent l'erreur qu'il y a, ou alors qu'ils changent leur volonté de nous maintenir dans un système colonial. Parce que en réalité, ce ne sont pas les textes qui manquent au Cameroun. Nous avons de très beaux textes, nous avons de la matière grise, nous avons même de la ressource humaine assez pointue pour gérer ces situations et que ce soit vraiment une gestion efficace et je dirais même efficiente. Mais le problème n'est pas au niveau des textes. Le problème est au niveau de la volonté politique. Parce que si la volonté qui est dans les textes était implémentée sur le terrain, vraiment, les choses iraient comme un train sur les rails. Et maintenant, il faut que le gouvernement en place sache que les consciences aujourd'hui au Cameroun sont beaucoup plus éveillées que dans les années 80, que dans les années 70, dans les années 50. Aujourd'hui au Cameroun, tout le monde est éveillé. Et lorsque vous présentez un texte à un Camerounais, vous lui dites voilà ce qui sera appliqué lorsque vous serez sur le terrain. Lorsque vous ne l'appliquez pas, ça devient un problème. Et c'est ça que c'est ce qui fait problème aujourd'hui avec toutes ces structures qu'on a mises sur pied. Il fallait que l'on respecte x facto ce qui est sur les textes. À statut spécial d'une région correspond à un certain nombre de critères. Il faut que ces critères soient respectés. D'ailleurs, M. Youf, tout à l'heure, vous avez dit que nous étions allés à cette élection. Justement, nous sommes partis à cette élection pour vous mettre face à ces réalités que les Camerounais vivent aujourd'hui. Où vous voulez créer des structures, vous voulez faire un saupoudrage et faire montrer à la communauté internationale que vous êtes trop démocrate. Mais par contre, vous ne faites rien dans ce sens.
Okay. Good evening, Mr. Liu, and to all the panelists. I wonder if the so-called special status is really being implemented. Mr. Liu, I've not seen how special the special status is. Daisy is writing from Kumba. Good evening, Mr. Liu. I give 100 gun salutes to Apostle Ambe. Special status means the people of the region benefit something and not bringing people from other regions to benefit. Akoja from Menka. Est-ce qu'il faut faire couvrir les choses ou il faut passer le temps à étudier et puis attendre?
Non, je pense qu'il y a un temps pour des études de faisabilité, il y a un temps pour les réalisations. Et les présidents des conseils régionaux ont ce qu'ils appellent les engagements qui sont pris. Et puis maintenant, il y a une évaluation de la performance. Bon, pour dire ce que M. Ndifor était en train de vouloir expliquer en disant tout simplement que les sources de revenus en ce qui concerne la constitution du budget des conseils régionaux ne sont pas que la dotation des 15%. Il y a la dotation des 15%. Qui est tel que ça a été expliqué tout à l'heure. Il y a maintenant les transferts de compétences et des ressources. Donc, ce qu'un ministère faisait et que ça revient maintenant au sens de la loi à compétence du conseil régional, le ministère va transférer cela avec les ressources nécessaires. Ça fait également une source de revenus. Il y a ce qu'on appelle la politique fiscale régionale. Sur le plan du statut spécial également, il y aura des spécificités des taxes, mais qui pourront être créées dans les zones en fonction des besoins de la politique fiscale du conseil régional. Donc, ce qui voudrait dire que c'est également une ressource. Les conseils régionaux peuvent avoir également des emprunts, mais sur la base des autorisations, parce qu'en réalité, s'ils ne remboursent pas ces emprunts, peut-être pris à l'étranger ou bien dans les banques, ça entrera dans le cadre de la dette intérieure de l'État. Donc, ce qu'on va dire que le ministère de l'économie et de la planification doit tout simplement aussi se rassurer que ça entre bel et bien en étroite ligne du plan régional de développement qui est donc présenté. Voilà une panoplie de sources de revenus des conseils régionaux. Ce n'est pas que la dotation des 15%. Mais aujourd'hui, on est sur la dotation de démarrage parce que tous les budgets étaient déjà mis en place. Juste pour vous dire que les 100 premiers jours étaient cela. La communication est en train d'être faite. Déjà, la sortie sans publicité de ce Cameroun Tribune a présenté les 9 présidents des conseils régionaux parce qu'il y a un qui est décédé, celui du Nord. Qui étaient décédés, il y a les 9 présidents des conseils régionaux, ont donné des points de presse. Et ils ont présenté la situation de l'évolution de leurs travaux des 100 premiers jours aujourd'hui. Nous invitons les Camerounais à lire. Nous invitons. Je dis les 100 premiers jours. Les 100 premiers. Non, les 100 premiers jours étaient pour préparer tous les conseils régionaux, avoir les documents cadres de fonctionnement, maintenant prêts à pouvoir présenter des budgets programmes. C'est de ça dont il s'agit. Sans budget programme, rien ne démarre.
Ok. Apostle Ambe, do you expect, should we be expecting the regional presidents to be more proactive and telling the people what is in the bag?
Except the... Like they said, that the governor was giving them the go-ahead. That is to say, the offices were created spontaneously. No particular plan was put in place, because if they are planning after election, it tells you the level of confusion. They are supposed to set up a structure before appointing people into offices. People will not enter into offices, and then they are sitting in their house, and then trying to structure it.
Were they elected or appointed?
Je voulais qu'on dise qu'on a fait le travail pour à leur place. C'est qui sont des pantins qui ont été élus.
Ils sont venus avec une vision.
C'est cette vision qui
est appelée. C'est moi qui est en train de parler.
Voilà.
C'est
youth. Donc, vous demandez. On ne pouvait pas le faire avant.
Non, I'm asking you the question.
No, but the Ministry of Decentralization was supposed to have put these things in.
That is one. There is a ministry running this thing. And the ministry is supposed to have set this thing in place before people have been elected into offices. You don't tell somebody that you are appointing him into an office and then you are going to build the office after. Offices are supposed to be waiting for individuals to walk into the offices. How can they enter into office without setting a plan of action? It means there was nothing in view. Let us be sincere here. And to the point I raised here, I have studied the special status of 121 regions over 40 countries in the world. There is a similarity in almost all those places. It's certain. You will never see somebody from Cook's Island, which is in New Zealand, heading another town that has special status. It's difficult. You will not see somebody in Guangzhou or in Guangxi heading in New Mongolia in China. It must be somebody from that region. That's why I was trying to raise a point that if at all this special status is what we call special status, then I'm sure the individuals or indigenous of those particular regions should be at the highest echelon of those regions. That's what makes a special status. Out of that context, we should give that thing another name. Don't call it special status. I'm not here to particularly divide Anglophone, Francophone. I'm here to point the fact that the special status in the actual context, if we are calling it special status, they should just remove that idea because the whole drama is a farce.
Okay. Tifo Richard, I don't know whether you are still there. Are you still there? Okay. And yeah, Tifo is gone. We want to say thank you to you at Tetilaris for coming to participate in today's edition of the program.
Thank you, Leo. I want to say that President Biya should for once start a project and complete it. If he has started special status, he should complete it and also go ahead to complete the ring road that he was supposed to personally supervise and complete other projects. Because if we have our development, if the common law is protected, if the Anglo-Saxon culture is protected, and I'm not sure people will be interested in who is governor or who is whatever, as long as they can have their roads, they can have pipeline water, electricity, good education, and get have their jobs and a favorable economy. People will not care. Anybody can be appointed anywhere, but the people will be pleased with the development, the healthcare, and everything. That Biya should, at least in these last days of this mandate, should show Cameroonians that indeed he had a vision for the country.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, Mr. Liu. To conclude, I have to say, if the special status is actually applied in context, it will solve 80% of the Anglophone crisis, I can guarantee you. They used to say, if somebody asks for a loaf of bread, give him half. That half enough can take away the hunger, no matter how annoyed the person may be. If we actually apply, the reason why I'm pressing hard on this special status is because I know it has the guarantee, if properly applied, it can solve the Anglophone crisis at least 75%, if not all. That's the truth. But now when we begin to rigmarole and begin to play hanky-panky with this particular special status, then we are not ready to resolve the Anglophone crisis.
Okay. Greetings, Mr. Liu and the family. I think the special status has a lot of strings, and therefore we can't say it's a special status just as Apostle said. Let's call a spade a spade. Mike is writing from Abu Dhabi. Merci d'être passé par ici.
Oui, ça a été un plaisir pour moi de venir sur votre plateau aujourd'hui, éclairer encore les lanternes des Camerounais sur la gestion de notre cité. Et nous voyons au terme de ce débat, pour conclure, que vraiment nous avons de bons textes, nous avons des structures, nous avons même des pensées, mais ces pensées sont mises à mal dans leur application au Cameroun. Et il faut juste que le gouvernement du Cameroun pense à rectifier l'outil parce que les consciences sont de plus en plus éveillées.
Ok. Hi, Mr. Liu and your guest. I love the program and the analysis of your guest. You are doing a great job. Innocent Barozil, writing from Bunaberry. This one says, if special status means people of that zone should be given their area, then what is a Bamike man from Bafoussam doing in Muyuka? Okay. Merci d'être venu, Monsieur You.
Le RDPC vous remercie d'avoir convié une fois de plus sur votre plateau. Nous voulons tout simplement rassurer nos concitoyens que le statut spécial a beaucoup de bonnes choses à apporter aux régions du Nord-Ouest et Sud-Ouest. Accordons du temps pour son implémentation. Et déjà, je peux vous rassurer déjà que les autres 8 régions souhaitent même avoir des dispositions particulières qui sont dans le cadre de ce statut spécial, y compris même le Public Independent Mediator et tout. Donc, nous sommes convaincus qu'il y a beaucoup de choses. Et maintenant, ils sont au travail. La première phase, c'est-à-dire celle d'évaluation des 100 premiers jours aujourd'hui, était donc pour la mise en place des budgets-programmes. C'est à partir de ces budgets-programmes-là que le travail va véritablement commencer en ce qui concerne le concret du citoyen, parce que tous les projets ont été pris en compte pour pouvoir maintenant mettre en exécution tous ces éléments-là.
Okay,
donc, faisons confiance au président de la République.
Monsieur Youth, merci beaucoup. Merci. Mm-hmm. Thank you to you, Eli and Desmond, and to you, Bertrand and Noel. Thank you all for producing this program. And to you, Tabby, Tambe Bryant, who is supervising the work we do out there. Stay blessed. Bye-bye.